Okay, welcome to this evening. As usual, we start with a little introduction for those who are new to our fancy club. And so this is us. We are Spec & Tech, and we are a great association. And as you can see, we are here hosting events about technology and so much stuff people think about it. So we started small back in 2016. We went over with so many events, growing up with more people, more events, more speakers, more ideas, until very, very big events such as the ICD Days last April, in which we hosted a huge event. Who was there? Okay, so yeah. You are still here, so happy to see you again. Our killer feature is having networking after these cool events, and not only with lovely people like this, but also with more professional stuff. In fact, you can not only find friends, as you can see by the tags, but also you can find networking and job opportunities, but Franz will tell you more about later. So today's event is about Genomic Bytes. And our first speaker for today is Matteo Rucco.
A big applause.
Okay. And with Andrea De Antoni. For our second event, for our second talk, we will have Mattia Bolzan. Okay, thank you so much. And now I'll leave the word to Franz.
Okay, a few more information. For those of you who are here for the first time, you can find all our events on specand.tech, who's our website. And you can find all the events that we've ever organized since 2016. And you can also be one of the speakers or one of the sponsors of our events. If you're also looking for a new job or you want to upscale your career, there's plenty of job opportunities out there from our sponsor partners and companies who gravitate around the ecosystem. And we also have this partnership with Trentino Sviluppo, and you can find more job opportunities up there. If you are interested, you can just go on our YouTube channel or whatever social media you're interested. The handle is always the same, Spec & Tech. It's easy, you can follow us there. So we generally chat the most on Telegram or Instagram, but feel free to choose whatever you like. There is one very important thing about Spec & Tech that started since 2016. It's an event driven by feedback. So tomorrow morning at 7:45, there's going to be an email telling you, hey, did you like the night? It sounds stupid, and it's yet another survey, you know, but we get those answers to make our events better. So we read all the questions, we read all the answers, and every time we try to improve a little piece of the event to make it nicer and to make it more interesting for people, for attendees. So it really takes 2 minutes. If you can give us your feedback, we generally like it. That's pretty it. We will start the night. One more thing. During the event, you can ask questions to the speakers. So at the end of the talks, we will ask the most upvoted questions. So even though you don't have a question, you can go to slido.do/specandtech, or you can go to Slido and insert the code specandtech. The most upvoted question, the most interesting questions will be asked to the speakers. So we are sure that there's a good quality of the questions. That's it. I will leave the floor to our friends from BioSentis. Warm applause.
All right. Thanks. Thank you for being here. And on behalf of BioSentis, we really like to thank you for your time, your attention, and your question. But let me introduce the topic of this talk, asking you a question. Do you like mosquitoes? You know, Do you know there are a few of them that can cause huge damages to human health? As well as there are other insects, such as fruit flies, that can cause huge damages to agriculture. Well, today's talk, Andrea and I will give you a brief presentation of Biosentis, which is a biotech startup, a spin-off of the Imperial College. And Biosentis is developing a new genetic control solution to tame the spreading of insects that are causing huge damages both to human health and agriculture. And the emergency, the urgency to provide a new novel solution is not invented by Biosentis. There are a lot of reports, both published by FAO and other institutions, telling us the size of the damage caused by insects such as locusts or Drosophila zucchii and others to the agriculture. There is an estimate that the insects will cause at least a percentage of 25 to agricultural production loss. Similar mosquitoes like small mosquitoes, Aedes aegypti, and similar are spreading huge diseases like Zika, dengue, yellow fever, and similar, and so forth. And this trend will get even worse in the future, because there are several environmental forces, such as growing population, global trade, people moving back and forth at high speed, climate change, unexpected geopolitical tension that are asking us to provide solution to control at a very high scale resolution the movement and the spreading of insects. Well, the idea of developing a solution for controlling insects is not new, but what makes Biosentis different with respect to other existing solutions is that our solution is going to be self-limiting in the time and space. It means once we have to release insects that will transmit genetic trait to the offspring. But as soon as we stop the release of the insects, the population, initial population, the wild type population, will restore over time. But with a proper release strategy, we can decide how long the effect of our transgene will last in the space, in the time. The commercial journey of Biosentis started last year, more or less. But the research background counts at least 20 years. It started with an idea from Andrea Crisanti and Austin Bort, both professors at the Imperial College. And Andrea Crisanti is the main founder of Biosentis. They conceptualized the concept of gene drives. That is a mechanism that overcomes the classical Mendelian pattern that we can use to transmit inheritance trait that might cause sterilization to the insect, to the offspring. This conceptualization was lucky because after a few years, a technology, a pure biological technology known as CRISPR-Cas9 was invented, was discovered and invented. And Crisanti Lab, Andrew Hammond, Kiru Skiru, all the founders of Biosentis spent day and night in the labs at the Imperial College, until they found the right gene to be edited and the right mechanism to guarantee the inheritance of the genetic modified gene. And they were lucky because they were funded also by the Target Malaria Project, a project funded mostly by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And they used the Bill and Melinda Gates effort, the target malaria, to improve and refine the research. And then, in the last few years, we made a commercial agreement with them through the Imperial College, and we founded BioScientis. So the commercial agreement is that BioScientis will leverage and exploit the research results coming from the Imperial College, but not for malaria. The Target Malaria project is still ongoing, and they focus on the malaria disease. BioScientis can deal with all the other diseases, such as yellow fever, dengue, which is quite challenging, and the same technology can be applied to other insect species fundamental for agriculture. Indeed, we are working on Drosophila suzuki, plus other insects. Drosophila suzuki is quite known in Trentino because it impacts apples and as well as small fruits. But besides BioScientis technology, the concept of developing solutions that are not pesticide or insecticide, thus based on the sterilization of individuals, was invented more or less 30 years ago. And the former solution, known as SIT, sterile insect technique, uses radiation. So the concept is to irradiate to light males and to release them. They will be fertile after sterilization, so that as soon as they mate, they won't produce any offspring. This is an eco-friendly solution to some extent, but it is too expensive, it is too costly, because you have to release hundreds and hundreds of sterile males for a single wild-type female. But it was a breaking technology. It opened a lot of research, same research that allowed BioScientis and Imperial before to develop their solution. But SIT, the sterilization insect technique, is not the only existing solution. There are some efforts, still current efforts, trying to improve SIT. But in addition to SIT, the sterilization made by radiation, other groups invented symbiotic approach, like they do release other insects that fight with the wild-type insects, like wasps, for example. But there are other approaches leveraging bacteria. The most famous one is known as Wolbachia. But unfortunately, Wolbachia can be used only for some specific mosquitoes. That is not a general solution. The third class of genetic control methods, and BioScientis belongs to this class, aims to provide editing at the DNA level, at the genome level. And the idea, again, once again, is to edit a specific portion of the genome so that the offspring will inherit the characteristic coming from the father and the mother. But the main take-home message from today's talk is not really on the molecular biology side, rather on how data science and computer science can help biology and the business of BioScientis to fine-tune or even to explore unseen path, research path. And the data science team is working on three main areas. One is bioinformatics, sequencing, alignments, and so forth. The second area is about developing automatization for supporting the lab operation. And the third, that is going to be covered today, is about how do we model insect populations and how do we model the inheritance mechanism of the modified genes. But what does it mean to edit and model and simulate an insect population? Well, an insect population is a complex system. A complex system is, in general, a system made by a huge amount of different entities, each of them equipped with their own behavior, And we study the emerging pattern while changing the initial condition of the population. Specifically, to tailor the conversation and the presentation to our domain, modeling and simulating individua of insect population means to develop models to represent the life cycle. How does an insect ranges from the egg to adult stage? How do they mate? How do they interact with the environment? And thus, we have to develop also a sub-model to represent the environment, such as small fruits and other environmental resources that are needed for the insect to develop. We have to capture and to formalize the interaction with the host, where they lay the eggs or their breeding site, and how they disperse in the space. So there exist several tools borrowed from mathematics. One of them is a differential equation. So in a while, Andrea will present you our own modeling and simulation platform, which leverages ordinary differential equation. For the sake of completeness, we use a stochastic delayed differential equation, a complicated way to say that we like to include stochasticity in our models, otherwise they are not compliant with nature. And we need to include the effect that the time delays, because at each stage, eggs, larvae, pupae, adults, and so forth, insects spend different life and different time to move from a state to another. So we have implemented, just a disclosure, I'm not going to tell you anything about the differential equation that are implemented in our simulator, but we have implemented all these differential equation systems in an online remote accessible simulator hosted by AWS Cloud. We use mostly Python, with a few add-ons on R, and this simulator will be presented by Andrea.
My time?
Yes.
Okay. So, hello everybody. Let's stay to the presentation. So, Bioscientis is not an IT company, it is a biotech company. And this means that our colleague basically has a background in gene editing, in biology, molecular biology, or entomology. And we, as computer scientists, need a way to communicate with them, to find a common language to translate the biology concept into software requirement. That is what we actually do. And to do this, to help in this communication challenge, we actually use some agile technique, such as the personas template. So let me present you Francesca. Francesca has a PhD in molecular biology and a strong scientific background from the academia, but this is her first job in a private company. So her daily duty is to design and then engineer transgenic construct for insect population control, what we have talked before. And the idea is that she would like to use modeling simulation, let's say, in order to support the decision making in the early stage of the product development. The main pain point is that she doesn't know how to code and she's not going to learn it. So we have, let's say, to fulfill this gap. But as a narrative for this demo, I will follow a story, and following Agile is going to be a user story. So Francesca, as a biologist, wants to compare the efficacy of different technologies so that she can decide where to invest the effort of her team. What is the best technology to develop, giving the ingredients of the single components. In a way, we can rephrase this as having these CRISPR ingredients, what is the best cake I can cook out of them? And okay, of course, it's going to be an oversimplified example, but it's not that far from what actually happens inside our lab. Last thing, so last slide, and we go for the demo. A little bit of the biology. We have this insect life cycle. So from eggs, individual becomes larvae, they grow to pupae, then they emerge as adults, female, males, they mate, and a new generation of eggs is produced. And this goes again. The point in our framework is that we can attach to all of these stages some information, a genotype, basically it's a string signature, and we can code and configure the transition rate from one stage to the other based on the genotype. So for example, we can say for this specific genotype, the transition from larvae to pupae is going to be zero. What does it mean? It means that individuals with that specific genotype will die after the larva stage and will not produce anymore. So let's see, let's all cross finger because it's going to be a live demo and you know how does it work with live demo. So what you see here, voila, is our web application. Actually, this is not the cloud deployment, it's a sandbox running on my machine. And we start our journey to answer Francesca's question from the models, so the genetic model catalog. This is a list of different technologies, and the question we are going to answer is, given two of them, which one is better? Which one is more efficient in suppressing basically the population rate? And we start with this, the first one that is called the autosomal editor. So a little bit, very few information about molecular biology. This technology is based on two different loci. A locus is just a place in the genome, and you can think that it maps to a gene that express or doesn't express a specific functionality at the phenotype level. Here we have a first locus, the autosomal editor, where we put our construct. The construct is made of two components, a Cas9, that is just a scissor, a molecular scissor that is able to cut the DNA strain, and the guide that can tell the Cas9 where on the DNA to cut. So if we compose the two together, we can basically decide to target another gene, what we call here the target gene, and to basically cut the DNA at that point. The cell is going to repair it, but by repairing it, it's going to insert some transcriptional error. And so the gene is not going to work anymore as before. Basically, we have a switch on and off for whatever gene we would like to touch. And if we do this for genes that are necessary for female fecundity, then we can have some interesting effect at the level of the population size. So just for going over, the target gene has different possible allele that are just letters. W stays for wild type and means a working version of the gene. And the R2 is a non-working version of the gene. So what happens after the cut and the repair? So generally speaking, mosquitoes, insects, us, we are all diploid organisms. Diploid means that we have two copies of each gene inside us. And so this is, let's say, an example of the genotype that we are going to release. In the first locus, the editor, we have a W and C, that means a single copy of the construct. And this C is going to work on the second target gene and to transform this W after the cut into R2, that is the non-functional version of it. Okay? So let's go one step back and rephrase. Francesca wants to know if she has to invest into the autosomal editor, actually making it inside the lab, or in something different. The something different that we are going to investigate is the main link editor here, that as the schematics show, is very, very similar to what we have just seen. The only difference is what is the editor locus. And this is basically the Y chromosome. I don't know if you know what is it, but it's just, if you have the Y chromosome, then you are a male. If you don't have a copy of it, then you are a female. So if we pay place our Cas9 and guide RNA on the wild locus, then our transgenic construct is going to be inherited only by males. And this, as we will see, can have a huge difference on the impact of the technology itself. So here we are just talking about the genetic characterization of our technology. It's not enough. We have also to talk about configuration. So let's focus, let's say, on the autosomal editor. We have two high-level, oversimplified configuration for it. One is the dominant sterile, and the other one is the recessive sterile. What does it mean? Let's open the first one, and let's go to this specific sub-configuration. Here, for each different genotype, all the possibility that we can build up comparing, combining the letters that we have seen, we can associate a fecundity rate. So normally it's one, but for those genotype that has an R2, that is the broken version of the gene, then we are putting the value to zero. This means that all the female that has an R2 on the target locus are not able to procreate anymore. And dominant means that you just need to break one copy of the L2 target locus. Recessive means that you have the same effect, but you need to break both of them. This is the idea. So going back, we have the model, we have the configuration for the model, and now with the simulator, we can simulate. So let's go for it. Here you can decide what is the insect species that you want and some parameterization. We are not going inside it. Let's just choose the mailing editor, what we have seen before, in the dominant sterile configuration. And just to tell you, this configuration comes with all this number of subconfigurations, so it is quite a complex model. We are not going to change the actual parameters. The default are OK, but you could as a user if you want. We are just going to this field subtab to change what is the release schema, so how we are going to release our transgenic male in the environment. So here we are saying what is the release genotype. It's male. It comes with a construct. We are going to release every 7 days, so each week for 1 year. We are going to release 2,000 of males, transgenic males. In this setting, the overall population is 20,000, so it's a 0.1 release ratio. One transgenic male against 10 wild type 1. Let's proceed further. This is MLEDS. We are at spec and tech. We choose deterministic simulation and we just execute. So it's going to take a few seconds and we should be able to find the result basically here in the catalog. Let's see if it's true. So spec and track, let's refresh. Okay, completed. This is the result. So two plots. We start from the male population. We started at the wild type level, 20K. At a certain point in time, we start releasing males with this different genotype. And as you can see, let's say this release schema looks like heartbeat, so we call it a pulse release schema. And we have the effect on the female population. So the number of female goes down. Actually, there is something else that is created, that is this FW, but we have an R2 here, so R2 means sterile, so we are not interested in it. Basically, by releasing this male, we are able to crash the female population up to a point that is very close to the suppression threshold of 95% of the initial population. So now Francesca has a way to simulate and forecast what is the effect of a technology that she can design and then develop in the environment. I did offline, of course, all the other simulation. And with this tool, basically, we are now able to compare the effect of different models. And the idea is very simple. It's this: we fix a release period, we fix a release frequency, and we just play with the size of the population. So instead of 5K, something more, something less, in order to see how much we have to release to crash the female target population. Basically, it is an optimization problem, minimization one. And let's go directly to the result that it is here. This is the analysis we would like to see. How to read this plot? We have release frequency in days on the X. So here we have 7 days is the weekly release. And this is the critical release ratio. So if we use the SAT, that is the standard technology Matteo spoke before, it means this number here, 5.21, means that in order to crash the population in 6 months, using a weekly release, we need to release 5 transgenic males for a wild type one. It's a lot. Instead, if we use Emily, for example, this is the other kind of curve. The lower the curve, the less insect we have to release, the less insect we have to rear, the less costly is the technology itself. So if you stay here, far below, is much better. And the other one, the autosomal editor, stays here. So both the technology are far better than, let's say, the standard one. And if you look at this, so the MLE is 0.3, basically, and outperform the other autosomal editor almost by a factor of 3 times. So to answer Francesca, she should for sure go for the Y-linked version of the technology. Last few seconds to show you, let's say, maybe a more intelligible comparison. This is the time series. We have MLE, that is our best technology on target. We release the same amount for the SAT. Basically, you note no difference. And the other technology are somehow in the middle. So that's all. I will pass back the ball to Matteo. Here it is.
Thanks, Andrea. So the tool that we have just seen has been validated against the lab data. It means it works very well in ideal setting for small cages without any environmental forces. But we must be prepared and ready for the release into the wild. And for that reason, we are really pushing a lot of efforts on both optimizing the release schema. The pools schema presented by Andrea is not the best one. We are exploiting techniques borrowed from artificial intelligence, such as Q-learning or PPO, as well as genetic algorithm to improve the delta between our technologies and competitor technologies, and also even to improve our own release patterns. We found out, for example, using a genetic algorithm, which is quite known approach for solving optimization problem, that we can even reduce a lot the number of transgenic insects carrying Biosentis technologies into the wild. Just to complete, we recently won a grant, a national grant, that aims to develop a digital twin of a wild-type population. To this end, we are going to use a different technology stack from the previous one, that it is based on a differential equation. Since the digital twin has capture the intersection between the population, the wild-type population, and the environment, how do they interact, we are going to use an agent-based model paradigm. And for who is interested, the technology that we adopted is known as PyFlame GPU. The reason is because we need to understand how our insect population interact with the environment. That is not easy peasy if done with our differential equation. agents based modeling are more suitable to capture this type of complex interaction. And this was the very last slide. We thank you once again for your time, your patience. Hope it was interesting for you. And let's have the questions, if any.
Thank you so much. It was incredibly interesting. And it was interesting for our audience too, because we have a lot of questions
really?
For you.
So Andrea, they are for you.
I'm not sure. Let's see.
So warm up, because it will be a lot. First, from the law point of view, did you previously ask the permission from the government to release a certain number of mosquitoes?
So this is a very, very good point. And of course, there is not a single law for all different countries. Each country follow their own regulation. So actually, Biosentis is not yet at the release point in the field. We are still in the lab operation. We are using a big climate chamber to study the population. But I can tell you what happened in other projects, such as SIT or Wolbachia, or even in the target malaria. They needed to obtain permission from the central government. There are certification body. You have to showcase that you are compliant with some procedure. You have to certify that some safety level of your product.
Okay. In maybe in relation to this, they ask, by reducing the population, don't you risk to change the equilibrium of an ecosystem?
This is another good point. So once again, Biosentis solutions are self-limited in time and space. It means as soon as we stop the release, the wild type population will be restored. So ours is a temporary solution. It doesn't last forever and ever like other control solutions, such as chemical control techniques. So in general, we don't release insects just because we like to release insects. We release insects because we have to tame a huge problem that can be a health care issue or agricultural problem. So one has always to ask what is the trade-off and the benefit of reducing, providing a temporary bias on the ecological system while reducing the burden of disease. So in general, we believe that all these techniques, beside Biosentis, other techniques like SIT or Wolbachia, they are needed to control huge problems. So we can allow temporary bias in the ecological system.
Okay. Still in relation to the concept of a temporary, is there a risk of reducing the genetic pool too much?
Well, this is a good point. There are a few techniques we cannot disclose or we don't have time today, but there are techniques that can be helped to stop and to dilute the genetic pool. So again, we can refactor the initial genetic pool.
Okay, and how do you model, simulate the enormous spatial spread of mosquitoes? How do you handle the fact that mosquitoes are distributed on a huge areas?
This is a very big, good point, and that's why we are moving from differential equation. Look, there are some differential equation like the PD that can be used to model spatial spread, but to improve the fine grain control, we are moving to agents. So the idea is the following. We are going to develop a multi-scale simulator in which we can both focus on field scale, small portion, or we can even scale up to regions. And the idea is that while we stick on a very small, like field scale, we can simulate the single individual. Well, why? As soon as we'll scale up to broader spaces, instead of simulating a specific, a single individual, we will simulate a cluster of individuals. And they will, of course, have a different dynamics, because instead of having a single individual, we are going to simulate a cluster or crowded space, crowded clouds representing a subset of individuals. But the ability of our simulator is to scale automatically from a space to another.
Okay. Now, a couple of questions on future.
Sorry, just to complement, sorry.
No worries.
Because this is very intriguing. We love what we are doing. Just for your reference, when we think about dispersal, we have to think about three different dispersal modules. One is a short-range dispersal, say, within a field. The second, we have wind-assisted dispersal. And this holds true only for some specific insects. For example, Drosophila suzukii is very biased by wind. While other mosquitoes, they are very good at controlling speed, wind. Then there is the third dispersal mode, that is the human-assisted dispersal. You can think about sheep or vans carrying woods or other materials, other compounds where larvae or pupa are. So when we think about dispersal, we have to think about at least three different modes and their combination. And again, the activation, moving from one mode to another, requires to scale from a field view to a regional view.
Okay. So a vision on the future. On a side, how could global warming impact the effectiveness of these technologies? And in link on this, why should I, as a financial investor, choose to invest in this approach instead of engineered resistant crops? What makes this approach competitive? So, on the long run.
I don't think they are competitive. They can be exploited together. But there is a difference. In general, as my understanding is that gene editing tailored to crops are very tailored to a specific crop, while ours is a framework. The same technology can be applied, for example, to Drosophila and mosquitoes. We target more or less the same gene. The main challenge is to identify the right portion of the genome where to insert the DNA. On the other part of the question, the global warming, so Drosophila suzukii, again, we are using a lot this animal model. Drosophila, which comes from Japan, wasn't present in Europe till 10 years ago. Because human-assisted dispersal, global weather changing, Drosophila was able to establish huge populations. The same happens for the fall armyworm, which targets corn. It was mostly present in Africa, in the sub-Saharan place, and now we are witnessing the establishment of some subpopulation even in Europe. So there are a lot of evidences, and that's why in our simulator we are going to incorporate also weather data, because there are several mathematical models leveraging the concept of growing degree day. How many days behind a specific temperature threshold are needed to observe the upset of a new population? There are a lot of literature about the correlation between weather data and the establishment of new population. Look, in Trentino, a few Drosophila population have been found also on the Dolomites, above thousands meter with respect to the sea level, and wasn't unexpected. Why? Because the temperature, the average daily temperature, is increasing too much. So these individuals are now able to establish their communities even in places where they weren't present a few years ago. I'm not speaking about the last century, a few years ago.
Okay, so an applause, please. Thank you so much. There were still many questions, so during the networking time, you can reach these awesome speakers and discuss with them with all the other doubts you have, and so you can make those questions later. Okay, so little advertisement break, because this evening we are here, but as a Spec and Tech, we do other stuff even outside Impact Hub. As this, we are embracing a project of digital alphabetization with grannies and grandpas. We have many students coming with to this event. Basically, we talk about how your smartphone works and how to avoid unpleasant...
I was saying that some of them are even ripetenti because they come multiple times to the same event to listen always the same concepts. It's fun.
Yeah, it's like when you were a child and you were watching the same Disney movie over and over again because you were enjoying it so much. And so these are the next date of these lectures. And so if you have some parents, grandmas, whoever you think can benefit from an event like this, enjoy it and learn something useful and new, share it, and they can come.
It's going to be in Vallagarina this time. So we are going to go in the south of Trentino. If you have relatives on that side, your parents, your uncles, grandparents, whatever, just send them. It's going to be fun. Okay, we told you there were some spoilers today. So dimmed lights, please, Samuel. The other one. The other one. Okay. Okay. Enjoy. Because this is the after movie of the Spec and Tech Retreat V4.
OpenMove ha deciso di partecipare come principale sponsor perché crede fortemente nei giovani, nell'innovazione e nella possibilità che i giovani possano essere i protagonisti dell'innovazione.
Dopo aver già partecipato a 3 retreat, appena sono arrivato in Price Hubble ho detto dobbiamo sponsorizzare il retreat di Spec and Tech perché conosco la gente che c'è, so quanto sono in gamba e so che è un'occasione veramente importante anche per le aziende per trovare nuove persone da assumere.
Dieda Group ha deciso di partecipare in quanto una delle nostre filosofie e asset strategici l'aspetto di open innovation.
Engineering ha deciso di essere sponsor in quanto è a favore di queste iniziative che puntano sul networking, essendo un po' questo il focus della nostra azienda.
Was it? How many of you were at the retreat? Can you raise your hands? Whoa, what a crowd. Nice. Okay, thanks a lot to the sponsors, of course, that made this possible at a ridiculous price. And it's again spoiler time before we move to the second talk by Prebiomics. Next event is going to be on the 31st of January, which means a lot of time. So enjoy your white holidays, enjoy the snow, enjoy your family time, and get back for the end of January because it's going to be fun. We're going to be talking about data visualization, which sounds pretty cool. And we're going to have two big speakers coming from out of Trentino, which is still far. So if you got any questions on that or spoilers, you can just ask us that after the event or just follow our channels and you will we will tell you more. On stage, Mattia Bozzan for second talk.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Francesco, for the introduction. Thanks to the organization for having me here tonight. It's a nice pleasure to talk to this nice audience. I'm not saying that because there are some of my colleagues in the audience, actually. I am Mattia Bolzan. I'm the Chief Technology Officer of Prebiomics, a biotech company based here in Trento. And tonight I will talk about the human microbiome, which could be the impact right now in the future of the human microbiome in healthcare, and how we can use metagenomics to study it. I tried before and I didn't learn very well, Francesco. So, microorganisms are everywhere. You can find it really in extremely variable and in extreme conditions around the world. So as you can see from the image, we found viruses, bacteria in alpine lakes, also here in Trentino. Also in thermal water, also here in Trentino. We had in the past a couple of studies on this, but also you can find in different types of soils. And obviously, you can find microorganisms on us as human beings. And when I started to talk about microbiome almost 10 years ago, I think, for the first time, I usually started the talk by asking to the audience if they ever heard about microbiome. But I will just keep that boring question tonight because I think the times are quite mature to not be so boring to ask that kind of question, so I will just jump to the definition of microbiome and why it is so important for us. So the human microbiome is a complex of microorganisms. Could be bacteria, viruses, fungi, archaea, and micro eukaryotes that are living in a specific body site in this case, since we are talking about human microbiome. So they could be in the surface of our skin, in our gut, they could be in the oral cavity, could be in the saliva, so they are really everywhere. And why they are so important? They are important to us because they could help us with some vital functions. For example, they could help us by degrading food components that could be indigestible for us given our genetic heritage. They helped us by modulating the immune system by interacting with our body. And this is quite an emerging field right now because it has been studied quite a lot. There is a lot of communication between the microbiota and the organisms, for example, in the response of cancer therapy. And also it could help us to prevent pathogen colonization in our body, so try to keep a sort of equilibrium in our body in terms of health state. In the last years, obviously, it's an emerging field, the microbiome study, and as you can see from the different publications, there is a huge impact in terms of healthcare. There have been a lot of links between the specific composition in the microbiome that have been linked to specific diseases. As you can see here, we found the link to type 2 diabetes, type 1 diabetes, colorectal cancer, arthritis, cirrhosis. So you can think that the microbiome is really relevant in terms of how we can manage in the future healthcare, also for this disease, but also for other diseases. How we can characterize the microbiome? We can do it in an old-fashioned microbiology style. I hope there are not microbiologists here, since I use the term old-fashioned. But anyway, you can just take the sample. You can isolate and then cultivate bacteria by using specific medium in the laboratory, specific condition, and then you can have a phenotypic characterization of those bacteria. That it means you can study the shape with a microscope, you can test them for antibiotic resistance, so you have all those lab testing to try to understand how the those microorganisms are interacting with the environment. And next step would be try to sequence the DNA of that isolate, so using DNA sequencing platform and then doing computational analysis, you can gather the genetic content of these organisms, and you have more information about these organisms with respect to the phenotypic characterization. For example, by studying the DNA content, you can find some specific mutation that can give that specific characteristic to that microorganisms. The main limitation in this case is that we cannot cultivate all microorganisms that are present in the sample because it's time consuming and we don't have protocols for all the microorganisms that there are in the world. And so that's why we are talking about metagenomics today, because metagenomics is the tool that we can use to study the whole genetic content of a biological sample without the need of cultivating the bacteria in the lab. So we are just sequence all the genetic material that is present in that sample, and then we can do the analysis. I will show you in the next slide a workflow, a comprehensive workflow about the metagenomics. The important thing is that by using metagenomics, we are overcoming the limitation of being able to know only the fraction of bacteria that we are able to cultivate. Because we can think about it that there is like 90% of bacteria that are almost uncultivable today, and with metagenomics we can try to understand also which could be the bacteria and which function can have the bacteria that we are not actually able to cultivate in the lab. So this is, as I told you before, quite a comprehensive workflow for the shotgun metagenomics method to study the microbiome. Obviously, the first step, as you can see here, is to have a sample. So we can have a sample, for example, we can have a stool sample or a saliva sample to be analyzed. The first steps are performed in the lab, so we have to extract the DNA of the microorganisms in the lab, and then we go directly to the sequencing. Given probably the background of the audience tonight, I will not give so much details about the wet lab process, because as you can see, we have a lot of steps that are involved for the computational analysis. The important thing is the processing in the lab is equally important to what we are doing next, because we need a good quality processing to have in order good quality data to be, for the analysis. So, after the sequencing, the result is to have a metagenome. This is, you can imagine that we have thousands of DNA fragments that are sequenced, that are coming from different species. And especially when we have studies with multiple samples, this is multiplied for the number of samples. So we have really terabytes of data that has to be analyzed in a proper way. So the important thing, obviously, is to have a sort of quality control as a first step. So you take the data. First thing that you have to do for the metagenomic study is try to remove the data that is not useful for the analysis. So we remove data coming from the human DNA of the host, for example. We remove the data coming from known contaminants. Also, we remove low quality data in order to reduce the data that you have to analyze and have really good quality data for the analysis. The next step that then is the analysis part, obviously, is the crucial part, and we show you later some tools that we can use to perform the analysis. Important thing is that we are using reference information that is publicly available to perform all the analysis so we can make use of the genomic sequences that are available for the bacteria in literature, for example. And then we can perform different types of analysis. Here I will highlight just a couple of them. So the important one in this case is the taxonomical profiling, so to see which are the species that are present in the sample. And then the other one is quite important is the functional analysis, so what these species can really do in the samples in terms of function. Then we can also integrate with the metadata information that we have in our project or in our study. That is equally important because if we have to interpret the data, it's important to have also the metadata to be able to correlate to different study conditions, for example. Here we have a list of different analyses that we can perform. I will not describe every one of these. Could be important biomarker discovery, for example, if you want to try to understand if there are specific bacteria that are associated with a specific disease, or it could be useful for example, strain tracking. Imagine you have an outbreak, for example, in the hospital, and you want to track the strain from which person is coming, how is mutating during his outbreak, and so on. These are some of the tools that we can use to do microbial profiling. So we are starting obviously from the DNA coming from the sequencing. We have reads that basically are what we are what the sequencing machine is reading from each DNA fragments, and we are using that to use then all the different analyses. Obviously, we have different tools. It doesn't mean that we have to use all of them, but depending on the goals of the project, you can just use one of them or some of them. So you can combine whatever is the goal of the project. For example, Human is a software that can give you the information about the functions that the bacteria can perform in a specific sample. Then we have Metaflan, that is the tool that I will show you as an example of analysis later, that is doing the taxonomic profiling, so you can see which are the species that are present in a specific sample, and you can see which is the relative abundance. And then we have Strainflan that could go even deeper in resolution with respect to Metaflan, because you are looking to the species, while with Strainflan you can go in a deeper resolution and trying to understand if there are different subspecies that have different, obviously, phenotypic traits with respect to the species level. And then we have other type of analysis. We can do phylogenetic analysis, or we can do also pangenome analysis, so try to see if, in terms of gene content, we can find some pattern in the sample that have common genes that are shared that can give those functions and make those samples different with respect to the other. So tonight I will just focus on the taxonomical profiling, because in terms of obviously time, I don't have enough time to talk about all the different tools that we are talking about. There are many different tools in literature available to do taxonomical profiling. I will take Metaflan because it's the one that we are using in prebiomics, and also is one that is just been developed here in Trento, a laboratory of computational metagenomics of Professor Nicola Segata. How it works, Metaflan, basically make use of the genome catalog that are available in literature. So it takes all the sequences that are available for the isolates in literature. The important step is the marker identification. So coming from the different genomes, it tries to recover which is a set of specific markers that could be useful to map the sequences that are coming from the your experiment. And these markers then, okay, that's not a good sign. You can use this set of specific markers to identify each specific species. So for each species, we have a specific set of markers that could be useful to identify the different species in a sample. In the end, we have a database that could be used to map the DNA fragments coming from your sample. I will show you a more practical example right now. It will be more easier to understand, probably. So you can imagine that for your experiment, you have your metagenome, that is a collection of reads, so DNA fragments coming from different species. You can imagine that you have thousands and thousands and thousands of them in your sample. What you can do is try to map these fragments to the markers that are available in a database of Metaflan. And the result, as you can see, you can have different fragments that are mapping to different species in the databases. Obviously, it's an oversimplified vision of the tool, and the result that you can have at the end is a sort of recap or relative abundance of the different species based on how many fragments map to the set of markers or that species. So you can, for example, have one species with more abundance than the others, and so on. Here I just show you as an example which is the real output from Metaflan, because Metaflan, the output of Metaflan is basically a table separated value file with a list of bacteria. You can imagine this just probably the list of a couple of bacteria present in a sample. So when you have to study, for example, thousands of samples with hundreds of bacteria, you can imagine that you have to handle all this kind of data, and it could be a huge amount of data. So it's important also to understand how we can then analyze and interpret the data, and I will show you how we can do it to try to find which could be possible links also with the different conditions that could be present in a study or a project. I didn't say anything about the company right now that I'm working on and with. So Prebiomics is born in 2017 as an academic startup of the University of Trento. Our main goal at that time was to develop a microbiome-based test for dentists in order to be able to help them in the treatment of the disease that are affecting dental implants. And in the meantime, we have been able also to extend this vision of using the microbiome not only to the oral field, but also to different fields like stool analysis or skin microbiome analysis. But what I want to focus on now is the first idea that we had, and this is actually the real application that we have right now that is coming into the market in the next future. As many startups, what we want to do when we start building or working on an idea is try to translate which are the academic findings that we found most of the time within the university in something that could be a market application, so that could be applied in a real life setting. In our case, it was the PhD thesis of one of the founders of Prebiomics, Dr. Paolo Ghensi. He did his thesis on the role of the microbiome in the diseases that are affecting dental implants. What he found is that there was a real strong signature in terms of microbiome. When I'm talking about signature, I'm talking about a specific complex of bacteria that has been found linked to the disease of the dental implants. And when I say strong, it's something that we didn't see for other diseases, because the microbiome that's been used for other diseases like colorectal cancer, but we didn't find any strong signature as we did in this case. That's why we thought a lot about it, and we think probably it's better to try to expand this idea and try to build a microbiome-based test for the dentist that could also help them to prevent the development of disease, and also prevent them to help them to give a better diagnosis to the patient, and have also personalized treatment and bring personalized medicine in the dental clinic setting. As I told you before, the test is becoming a reality right now. So as you can see here, if you remember the workflow that I showed you before for the shotgun metagenomics, what we are actually doing is try to translating the workflow into a market application. We have our sample collection kit, so we are able to collect our sample that will be analyzed then in the laboratory. We have a validated pipeline for the processing, the laboratory, also for the analysis, and everything then is finalized in a sort of report that it will give to the dentist to help them to give a better personalized plan to their patients, basically. This is just to show you which is the results that we had right now in terms of development of our startup. But what we did, obviously, to do is in order to be able to have this test right now in the market, it was to have a huge R&D program in the last couple of years that have involved more than 50 dental clinics in Italy. We have recruited more than 1,000 patients. We collect a lot of data. And I'm showing you here on the right, which are the study group conditions. Usually, when I show the study groups in this kind of talk, I'm using splatter images of tooth with blood, something like that. But we are close to Christmas, so I feel it was better to avoid to you that kind of vision. It's important anyway to know the group, the study groups, because in the next slides I will show you some results of the analysis. So we can have healthy dental implants. As you can imagine, they are perfectly healthy. They don't have any sign of disease. We can have dental implants with mucositis. That is a sort of intermediate stage of disease. We have inflammation. It's not the final stage of disease. It could be reversible and still curable for the dentist. And then we have perimplantitis. When you have the final stage of disease, you have bone loss, and you have a lot of probability that you can lose your dental implant. So it's very important to not arrive to this stage. This percentage is just the distribution of the patients that we have in our study. And we try to have a balance between the different groups in order to have obviously the results that could be balanced in terms of algorithms that we are using also for further analysis. So, the Metaflan output I showed you in the slide before, what we can do when we have this kind of output and you have to multiply it for hundreds of bacteria and thousands of samples. We need to find a way to visualize the data and try to get some useful information from the huge amount of data that we have. One of the measures that we can use is alpha diversity. Alpha diversity is used to measure the diversity with Viva samples. There are different metrics that we can use for alpha diversity. In our case, we use the species count, that is very basic. We are just counting in a sample how many species, bacterial species, we have found. It does not take into account how abundant are the different species, but anyway, it can give you, as you can see here, already some insights with the difference with respect to the different groups. For example, to us, it was clear that there is a clear difference between the healthy samples that have more or less 70 different bacterial species on average with respect to the one that are diseased. So we can probably say that if you have the disease, you have a less number of species. And as a rule of thumb, in the microbiome field, the higher is the diversity of your microbiome, the higher is the count of the bacterium in your microbiome, you should be more healthier. So this could be an evidence that is something is not going very well in that study groups, obviously. Another measurement that we can use to analyze the microbiome data is the beta diversity. So trying to understand how different in the microbial composition could be two samples, for example. And in this case, what we take into account is also the different abundance of the species within the samples. In this case, we use the break artist instance as a metric for the beta diversity. The scale is from 0 to 1. If you have 0, basically you have to you are looking to two samples that are basically the same. And when you are close to 1, you have samples that are basically completely different in terms of the different species abundance. Also, as you can see here, we have a sort of confirmation, especially for the perimplantitis study group, that something is really different with respect to the LT1, because here you can see that the LT1 is close to 1, so it means that you have a more variable microbiome that is changing in the healthy samples more, and you have also different bacteria that are involved in the composition of an healthy microbiome. Instead of the perimplantatis microbiome, can see a decrease, so that means that the microbiome is changing a lot less when you have perimplantitis, and also it could be that in this case you have a more defined complex of bacteria that are characterizing that study group. To have further confirmation, you can use heat maps that I think are very useful when you are using large data sets and you have a lot of number of samples, a lot of bacteria to visualize data. And it's really striking, as you can see difference in the different groups, and you can immediately identify if there are some bacteria that are more abundant in one specific group with respect to another. In this case, in this plot, we have the different groups. In green, we have the LT samples here. In blue, we have the mucositis, and in red, we have the perimplantitis. Here, we have a list of the top bacteria that are present in each group. And each square basically is representing the relative abundance of that species in one sample. What we are reporting here basically is the effect size, so how statistically relevant is that bacteria in that group with respect to the other group. What I want to show you here basically is a confirmation of what we have found also in the slides before. This is the group of perimplantitis samples, and this is the group of bacteria that is significantly associated to that specific group. So that it means, as you can see here, that this particular group of bacteria that you can see is more in yellow, red, so it means that they have an higher abundance. They are not present, as you can see here, in the healthy samples. Basically, you don't have, they are not present in the healthy samples, and also you don't have healthy bacteria, the main healthy bacteria in the perimplantitis group. As a further confirmation, we looked also to the bacteria, Porphyromonas gingivalis, Tannerella forsythia, Porphyromonas endodontalis, have been all bacteria that have been associated to the perimplantitis disease in the past in the literature. The thing by using metagenomics is that we have been also be able to find some new bacteria that have never been associated to this disease. It is something that was really impactful in the field of dental implant diseases, because we have been able to find new species associated to the disease that was not possible to find them in previous study. Another thing that we can do is try to implement machine learning algorithms, because we have a lot of data coming from the microbiome data, but we also have a lot of health clinical parameters collected during the study, because we have personal data like age, gender, BMI, we have lifestyle data, systemic health data like association with different systemic diseases like diabetes, cardiovascular diseases. Then we have data from oral health, dental implant. It's a lot of data, and we try to understand if machine learning could help us to find some links between the microbial features that we have in our samples and the clinical metadata. As I can show you here, especially for the comparison with from healthy dental implants and peri-implantitis dental implants, we can find that there is a distinctive difference between the two groups, and we can also understand that machine learning could help us to be a sort of have a sort of prediction power by looking to the microbiome and try to identify the classify the different samples in the different study groups by looking just to the microbiome. We just don't need to take into account all the clinical data, but just have some of that. But with an accuracy of 96%, we have been able to assign each sample to a group that could be healthy or peri-implantitis. But how we can translate all this kind of findings in something that could be useful for our test that I showed you before that we want to bring to the market. What we developed is a sort of score, the peri-implant microbiome score, that is basically giving you a sort of assessment of the risk of development of the diseases that affect the dental implants. It's a sort of scale that goes from zero, that it means that you have no risk of development of peri-implant diseases, to 100, it could be that you have a high risk of development of disease. This is built by using the Radon Forest algorithm, by using the microbial data that we have in our databases, and also using some of the clinical data that we have been collected. The important thing is that we want to bring something to the dentist and also to the patient that could be an immediate information, because everyone could see from a score if the situation right in that moment is a situation that you can underestimate or that you have really taken into account seriously. So the important thing here also is that with this methodology and also with this implementation, we have been able also to find the bacterial biomarkers that I showed you before, like the Porphyromonas gingivalis or the Porphyromonas endodontalis. We have been able also to identify those biomarkers before there is a real clinical manifestation of the disease for the dentist, because it happens a lot of times that by clinical evaluation of the dental implant, the dentist didn't see any sign of disease development, but we have seen in our study that it could be already the presence of some bacteria that could have also an high score, so they could have an high risk of development of disease. And so in this way, by implementing this kind of information, we can also bring disease prevention into the field, and not only to have a more precise diagnosis for the disease. What we want to do in the future is try to translate what we found in the oral field, also in different fields of the human microbiome. And we built our laboratory at the start of this year, here in Trento. It's a next-generation sequencing facility, is semi-automated in terms of processing of human samples. We have 10 laboratory technicians that are working on that. We are able to process thousands of samples, actually, every week. Could be stool samples, oral samples, or something, everything that is related to the human body. And we are also building a team of computational scientists that we are obviously trying to increase even further, because there is a lot of room optimization in terms of pipelines that we are using. Also, we are want to try to implement some solutions on the cloud. And so there is always room for everyone, I would say, now in probiomics to make an impact on that. I don't want to sound too much cheesy probably right now, but if I have to say, I'm not taking anything for granted as a startupper, because it's a few years that I work in the startup, and I'm not taking anything for granted for the people I work with and I work for. So if I'm talking right now about my company, about what we are doing and the future that we want to have for a better healthcare, is thanks also to the team that you can see here in the picture. So if there will be an applause at the end of the talk, the applause will be for the whole team of Prebiomics, not just for me. I'm not saying that because I have some colleagues here in the audience. That's it. Thank you very much. If you have any questions.
There's plenty of questions and we won't be able to ask all of them. But
great.
In front of a drink later on, you can answer to all of them. First, how does the metagenomic result influence the dentist therapeutic intervention choice of antibiotic?
Yeah, that's for sure something that we are trying to implement. We have also a new project coming from that is funding from the European Commission that is really focused on the therapeutic intervention that we can do taking into account the metagenomics data. What we want to do for sure is try to reduce the antibiotic usage. It is something that is really important to do in the future because there is an increase, an emergency of antibiotic resistance for the bacteria, the so-called superbacteria that are resistant to multiple antibiotics. And this is something that we want to do implement, obviously, in the close future in our report in order to give to the dentist instruction and a personalized treatment for the patient. So also the choice of the right antibiotics, something that we'll for sure give to the dentist.
Okay. Can a healthy microbiome be transplanted to another host?
In the oral field right now, no. Obviously, there is the fecal microbial transplantation that is actually performed. It can be useful for infection from Clostridium difficile in the gut. So it's something that is actually performed. Could be in the future that we have some magic that we can do also in different type of microbiome, in type different type of body sets, but it's something that is already a reality for some diseases, especially for the gut.
Interesting. Aren't the data in the databases obtained from cultivated bacteria with those cool techniques? How did we isolate the DNA of non-cultivable bacteria?
It's something that you try to do basically by testing it. I mean, you can sequence, you can retrieve basically the sequence from metagenomics of unknown bacteria. Then you can try to build some markers that you can try to target through PCR. But then obviously, when you have to cultivate them, you have to start with some medium, and then you have tried to start to pick whatever it is growing and try to isolate them, try to grow them in different condition, and then sequence them and try to see if there could be a link with what you have found in the metagenomics results to what you have found in the lab. It's not something that is so straightforward, obviously. It's something that is really going on actually in the laboratory of Professor Segata in Trento. And I know that is frustrating, but it's something that obviously it has to be done because it's something that it could give a further validation of what you can get from metagenomics, obviously, and you can expand then all the information that are available in databases, obviously. So
there's people in the audience that know shit. And they're asking, is this taxonomy profiling system able to do also de novo sequencing, or is it only mapping on known genomes?
You can do, obviously, de novo assembly. I mean, you can assemble from the raw reads. You can assemble the single bacteria genomes. The thing in metagenomics is it's not that easy because you need a huge amount of data to get a good quality of the genome of the single species that is present in the sample, by something that obviously it can be performed. If you have a reference, obviously, genome that you can map for is even easier, but it's not really mandatory right now. It's something that you can build also without any reference available in the database.
There's plenty more questions. I just ask you a final one. Is a damaged microbiome a consequence of an illness, or a damaged microbiome from other causes leaves room to the development of an illness?
Can you repeat the first one?
Is a damaged microbiome a consequence of an illness, or a damaged microbiome leaves room to the development of an illness? So is a cause
that's
or a...
That's a good question, and I think it could be both. We don't have any clear idea of which is the impact of the microbiome. We have some ideas, as you can see from the different publication that I showed you before, also from the result that we have in our study. We don't know if it is correlation, if it is causation. It's always the same thing as a scientist that you need to evaluate if it is something that is correlated with the disease state or if it is the cause of the disease state. So it's not so straightforward most of the times, the answer to this question. But for some study, for sure, the changes in the microbiome is something that is causing the illness, for sure. What is causing the changes in the microbiome is something else, obviously, because it could be lifestyle, it could be anything. So it's not that straightforward, the question most of the times, the answer most of the times in this case.
Okay, thanks, Mattia. Another round of applause.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Almost done with the night, so let me just present a few more slides before we close. So we told you there were some spoilers tonight. There's one more, and it will go real quick. It's the design of the new T-shirt of Spec & Tech. It's coming January 2024, and it's going to be different from anything you've seen before. This is just a design. It will have a different color. It will have a different textile. But you might understand something, and it will be quite cool. So in January, you will see when we launch it. Tonight, there won't be any T-shirt. Last time, we sold everything, even the T-shirt from 2018. It was insane. So the reason why I have these two slides to wrap you in gap is because we are asking for your support, and it's quite easy, as we were doing with the slides on Wikipedia, probably. This is just a breakdown of our costs as an association. As you see here, is the incomes that we, the funding that we get, and these are the expenses. And as we see, is a bagno di sangue. actually, this is the reality because if we check only the donation and we subtract the sponsoring from companies, it's even worse. So we are continuously losing money as if we were a startup, but we are not backed by VCs. So what you can do to support us is you can leave a donation at the desk down there, even 1 euro just to repay the beer, or 2 euro for the beer and the spec, etc., just to help the association survive. You can donate in any way, and if you go there at the desk, there's plenty of gadgets. We don't have the T-shirts yet, but there's plenty of stickers and a bunch of swag that you can grab for free, of course. If you're there, just drop a coin, even a digital one, okay? That's pretty it for the event.